Dear students, again, thank you for listening of our video part two of the central nervous system. We start with the brainstem. As we said in the at the beginning of the explanation or explanatory introduction of the spinal cord, the brain consists of the whole brain consists of the older portions, which is called brainstem, and then the higher levels. So starting with the important part, brainstem, important because it contains many vital centers for the life. It consists of the mesencephalon, it consists of the pons varoli, varoli, and medulla oblongata. So there are three main portions. When we look at their general structure, so the whole brainstem could be defined as the system, which consists of three segments, repeating it on this sagittal section. So we are looking first of all the sagittal section. So we are looking at the mesencephalon, then pons, this is the second one, and finally oblongata. The lower part is then the spinal cord. So back to the to this section. So we see on the section that we have three portions. We said mesencephalon, pons, and oblongata. Above them lies cerebellum. Yes, cerebellum will be explained as a separate topic. The space between cerebellum and the brainstem contains the cerebrospinal fluid, and the fluid lies in the conical space called fourth ventricle. You remember from the explanation of the layers of the spinal cord, or better, the coverings of the spinal cord, the meninges, we have mentioned the word choroid plexus. We said that choroid plexus is situated in the ventricles of the brain. It produces the important cerebrospinal fluid, which flows and circulates from the ventricles around the whole brain and also the spinal cord. Concerning the presence of the choroid plexus, it's found in all the ventricles. So all the ventricles contain the choroid plexus, producing cerebrospinal fluid. Good. Then back to the section. The interconnection between the third and fourth ventricle. Third ventricle is here, fourth ventricle is here. So the interconnection between these two ventricles is called the aqueduct, or cerebral aqueduct, or mesencephalic aqueduct. Is narrow canal passing through the mesencephalon. The dorsal part of mesencephalon, of this mesencephalon, is called tectum, or better, at this moment, it's better to say the corpora quadrigemina, because it contains of four bodies, which contain the subcortical centers of the pathway of hearing and vision. So this is one thing. This is mesencephalon. Oblongata is wider, thicker, and also so pons is wider, and also oblongata. We said that the all three portions form the floor of the fourth ventricle, and we call it rhomboid fossa. This term is important for us because rhomboid fossa will be mentioned together with the location or description of the location of the nuclei of the cranial nerves. So the following would be the cross section. So we started with sagittal section showing three segments, three parts, and the next one would be the cross section on the part of the next page. So this is okay. This is excellent. So on the cross section, what we see the layers. We call it stratification. As we use the word tectum, this is the most cranial portion or segment or part. Then follows the segmentum, and then the basis. Tectum, tegmentum, a basis, or also we call it crura cerebri or crura of cerebrum. The colors indicate that they are different different systems, motor as well as sensory. So we see the motor in red and sensory in blue. So if the tectum is principal bluish because it contains the bluish colors, the sensory nuclei, the tegmentum contains both larger nucleus like, for instance, this red nucleus ruber. We mentioned also the name nucleus ruber in the tract rubrospinal, rubrospinalis. We see also the other tracts and also the sensory, there are more sensory tracts which ascend. Finally, the basis, crura. Crura consists only of the descending tracts. The example of the diagram, very good example is the mesencephalon, because in the mesencephalon we see well these three layers, three parts, tectum, tegmentum, basis. In the other parts, as the oblongata and pons, not that well, but also all these three parts of the brainstem have the same stratification. And then we can look at the location of nuclei of the cranial nerves of the rhomboid fossa. We said that rhomboid fossa is important for the description of the location nuclei. We try to pay full attention to first of diagrams. You remember this is the only half looking at the basal plate and the alar plate. This was the base of the explanation of the location of the nuclei. So we are repeating the same. We also said that between the motor plate and alar plate lies the sulcus groove. We call it sulcus limitans. So the structures or nuclei found on the lateral side belong to the sensory, on the medial side belong to the motor systems. When we look at the portions, the alar plate has two parts or zones. This is the somatosensory and viscerosensory. The classification is very clear. Somatosensory receiving the impulse from the somatic sensor sensor receptors. Viscero from the internal organs. Then follows the visceromotor, sending the impulses via the autonomic nerves to the internal organs, and the somatomotor, which is the same, like the somatosensory corresponding fibers run to the of course descending run to the skeletal muscles. So these are four zones, and when we remember the location of the four zones, so we can start with description of the contents of the rhomboid fossa. So starting with the median plane, we are again on the median plane. This is the same here. So I'm drawing or explaining also the diagram showing on the opposite side. Of course, they must be identical. So starting with the motor, this is the line of the motor nuclei. Look at, first of all, at the colliculi. So we said that these are the colliculi and superior inferior belonging or forming the corpora quadrigemina. So we said that this part is called tectum of mesencephalon and contains the superior colliculi and also inferior colliculi. These colliculi represent subcortical centers of vision, the superior colliculi, and hearing, the inferior colliculi. This is just for your information. But these colliculi contain also nuclei, nucleus of nerve number 3, oculomotor, number 4, trochlear, and in the lower position is also nucleus of nerve number 6, abducens. When we look at the location in red are the motor nuclei. All of them are situated on the medial row. So this is again repeating number 3, number 4, number 6. All of them are oculomotor nerves controlling the movements of the bulb of oculus, of the eye, and also number 12 for the muscles of the tongue, you remember. So they, these four, number 3, 4, 6, and 12, lie in one line. This is the median line, then in the lateral line, we are still in the motor part, because sulcus limitans lies exactly here. So clearing. So the other motor nuclei or nuclei of motor nerves are number 5, number 7, number 9, 10, 11. Number 5 is separate motor nucleus of trigeminus. Number 7, the same, but number 9, 10, and 11 are those three nerves forming the nucleus ambiguus. So the motor nucleus in red is called nucleus ambiguus. So we see now all the motor nuclei, but close to them are situated also nerves which are called parasympathetic. We remember nuclei. The first one is Edinger Westphal nucleus, belonging to the number 3 as the accessor nucleus. Then we see the superior salivator nucleus. Yes, this is number 7. And also inferior salivator nucleus, belonging to the number 9. And finally, nervus dorsalis nervi vagi. Without label, doesn't matter. This is the parasympathetic nucleus of nerve number 10. So in green number are the nuclei of the parasympathetic system. Red are the motor nuclei arranged into rows. One row is medial, one row is lateral. Concerning the position, the nerves pass caudale. The only one nerve, the nerve number 4, lies on the dorsal side and then runs on the lateral side and descend also caudale. So all these are nerves, the motor ones. When we look at the position of the sulcus limitans, which is here, sulcus limitans separates the motor area from the sensory motor and then the sensory area. So now we try to describe the sensory nuclei. So first of all, we start with the large and long nucleus or nuclei belonging to the nerve number 5. Trigeminus. First one is the mesencephalic nucleus. We said mesencephalic nucleus is that one which is long, descending from the mesencephalon as a narrow nucleus. It receives the impulses as the proprioception. The next one is the main or principal nucleus of trigeminus. This is the principal nucleus for the touch pressure, etc. So discriminative touch. And finally, the last one is spinal nucleus of the trigeminus, typical nociceptive, that means for pain perception. So repeating, first one, nucleus, mesencephalic, then main nucleus of trigeminus, and finally spinal nucleus. Then follows the nucleus, which is situated in its close proximity. It's the nucleus of solitary tract. We use also the gustatory nucleus, although it's not the whole nucleus which is occupied by the portion of the gustatory, but we call it gustatory nucleus for taste. And finally, we are looking at the nuclei which belong to the tract of hearing and equilibrium. So they are two cochlear nuclei involved in the tract of hearing, and also four nuclei, 1, 2, 3, 4, we call them four vestibular nuclei, which are integral part of the organ of equilibrium. So there are two different pathways, equilibrium and hearing. This is the review of the position of the nuclei situated in the rhomboid fossa. And then as the next part is, it seems to be more complicated, but very important for the understanding of the structures and also actions of the brain, which will be studied in physiology, neurophysiology. We will look at the architecture of the brainstem. So on the following page, we start with the cross sections. So title of all the sections will be, as you see, cross sections at different levels. Yes, crossing, clearing, and then we are looking at the first one, oblongata. Yes. Oblongata is complicated. So as you see, we start from the lower level, we go up. So we have to draw minimum two sections. As the introduction or introductory notes, I would like to say that we are showing here the most typical structures found at any level of the brainstem or or the spinal cord, or the other levels of the brain. You can see in the atlases also the other sections, other structures. This means that this is not principal difference, or there are no mistakes in the sections. It always depends at the position. Even 1 millimeter above one position. So when we look at the sections, always we have to look at what level we are. So even 1 or 2 millimeters above the level, we are in the other section and we see a little bit different position or different structures. So this is the reason why we cannot explain at one section all of them. So first of all, we are looking at the first section at the level of pyramidal decussation. Eliminating the morphological drawings or the diagrams showing the surface of the brainstem, because you can look at these diagrams in the atlases in the books. So we will see that on the inferior side, there is a very, very important high elevation pyramidal tracts, or we call it also where the place where they cross each other, we call it decussation of pyramids. This is a motor system. So at this level, we see the first diagram. Again, as usually, we draw the half of the diagram. So here we have the median plane. Starting with some abbreviations, repeating the posterior funiculi, posterior fasciculi, with fasciculus gracilis, fasciculus cuneatus. We see it again here, posterior funiculi, gracilis, cuneatus. They have four segments. This is what we said, sacral, sacral, lumbar, thoracic, cervical, correct. Then we see the spinal nucleus from the previous drawing of cranial nerve number 5, trigeminus. Then we see lateral spinothalamic tract. We said this is nociceptive, transmitting pain, protopathic. Then we see posterior and anterior spinocerebellar tracts. These two are spinal. Cerebral typical proprioceptive system. Then here we have the lateral pyramidal tract. We said that it has four segments, as you remember from previous description, and it passes to the opposite side, crossing the median plane. And the same is with this tract, which is found on the bottom of this drawing. And this is called anterior pyramidal tract. So we see the lateral and anterior. They run from the opposite side, and in the place where they cross each other is called decussation. There is also important reticular formation. We will speak about reticular formation in the one specific lecture, which must be fully devoted to reticular formation, which is important complex of the neurons and their interconnections in the whole extent of the brainstem and also part of the spinal cord. Reticular formation, we said. Then we see here the central canal. Yes, this was that canal, which is called the mesencephalic aqueduct, of course, in the upper portion of the brainstem. So the central canal contains the cerebrospinal fluid. And around this central canal is the area, a circular area, called the central gray matter, important for production of endorphins, acting against the pain, perception of the pain. And also we have in yellow that typical medial longitudinal fasciculus. This was already explained in the previous text of the spinal cord. This is that one providing the cooperation between the receptors of the hearing and vision and the motor system of the head and neck. So this was the first introduction showing how is it with the distribution of the main portion and main tracts found at the first diagram, showing the level of the pyramidal decussation. We mentioned that L is the spinothalamic. We said it's lateral spinothalamic, but it's not explained that spinothalamic runs together with the spinoreticular and spinotectal. All of them are nociceptive. Note, please, there is also a new nerve number 11 accessory situated on the lateral side. So we can go to the next page. Next page is the oblongata at the level of the olivar nuclei. We can go more. Yes, we can see this page. We need the whole page. Excellent. So it seems to be more complicated, but trust me, this is, as we said, not so complicated. The structures and systems are logically arranged in the whole section, and if we will study one by one, so then finally I'm sure it will be able to draw your own diagrams. Of course, I mean the correct diagrams. So we are looking again on the half of the diagram. We are at the median plane, full body orientation. We have here the pyramidal tract. You have here also the olivary nucleus. Olive is also seen on the surface as the elevation, olivary nucleus, important for the motor systems, and also pyramidal. So everything what is red is motor, what is blue is sensory, and the other colors are like the yellow, they show the nerves, as for instance cranial nerve number 10 or 12 is motor. So sometimes we use, because it's mixed, we use just general color for nerves is yellow, but if this is purely motor, so then we use red or blue, etc. So starting with the roof. So this is the roof of the fourth ventricle. So I'm surrounding the fourth ventricle, half of them, of all the structures belonging, because the roof is the lamina of the fourth ventricle. And then we see the base in the solid line, base divided by the position of the sulcus limitans. So sulcus limitans is that one separating the alar plate from the motor plate. So we are repeating it several times. Of course, the cavity contains the cerebrospinal fluid, as every ventricle contains the cerebrospinal fluid. So this is one thing. We see the fourth ventricle. So we are now on the floor. And just beneath the floor, we see the following nerves. Must be in the medial row, the nerve number 12, motor nucleus of cranial nerve number 12. It must be also the dorsal nucleus of vagus, parasympathetic nerve. Then laterally, we see the nucleus of solitary tract, definitely. And a little deeper is the spinal nucleus of trigeminus, also belonging to the complex of sensory. Deeper is also nucleus ambiguus. Note please that we have drawn in the previous diagram showing the rhomboid fossa, all the nuclei as they are situated at the same level. No, they are not at the same level. You see that some of them are deeper, but everything belongs to the to this position, because it is sulcus limitans, and sulcus limitans separates the motor part from the sensory. That we see the nucleus ambiguus belonging to the nerve nuclei or motor nuclei of nerve number 9, 10, 11. So I'm repeating, maybe that it will have some effect. So these three fibers, sensory, parasympathetic, and motor, finally form the nerve number 10, vagus. This is what we said. Laterally, we have the fasciculus gracilis and cuneatus. Yes, because they can't be situated here, because we are in the roof, in the thin lamina. Posterior funiculi for the proprioception and discriminative touch, both of them. We see a special portion, which is called peduncle. This one is the inferior cerebellum. Without any details, we have to mention that peduncle is the connection, is a bridge between the oblongata with the cerebellum, because there are three peduncles. This one is inferior cerebellar peduncle, because it provides the connection between oblongata and cerebellum. That will be, then following will be the middle, and then finally will be superior. So there are three peduncles. This is the first one. And then here you have the olivary nucleus. Olivary nucleus is the motor nucleus, important for motor activities. It has also the accessory nuclei. Then caudally we see the pyramidal tracts, and these are motor, definitely. And just below to them are small nuclei. We call them arcuate nuclei, which play the same role as the pyramidal tract, so which are also motor nuclei. Then finally, we are in the central portion of the section. We see the reticular formation nuclei, and also that yellowish medial longitudinal fasciculus mentioned several times. And finally, the larger structure is the complex of ascending tracts. We call it medial lemniscus. It's written ascending sensory tracts. Yes, it contains complex of sensory tracts and will be described also in all the sections above that. And finally, we see also here tectospinal. This is motor descending. As explained here, inferior cerebral parenchyma is the interconnection between oblongata cerebellum. Medial lemniscus is the sensory complex of sensory tracts. So this is that section. We can go to the following page, the next page. Everything was explained, floor fossa, everything was clear, nothing more. And then we go to the number three. This is pons varoli or varoli. We are drawing just one section in the midpoint. This is sufficient. So again, starting from the median plane, we see also the roof of the ventricle. Here is the cerebrospinal fluid. This is what we said. Then on the ventral or in the ventral position are corticospinal tracts. They are like separated tracts, but of course they are all of them the motor ones. And below them in the pons are the nuclei, which are called pontine nuclei. So in the oblongata we see the tracts, but here or arcuate, but here are the pontine nuclei. Pons has similar function as the oblongata. We said that there are so many important vital centers. All of them are situated in the reticular formation. So this will be explained in the next lecture. And now we are looking at the position of the tracts and nuclei. Again, we can start now from the medial lemniscus. We said that this is the complex of the ascending tracts, general sensational sensory, number one. Then here we said that there is a reticular formation. Then here is the medial longitudinal fasciculus, mentioned also several times. Then here we see two motor nuclei. One is a motor nucleus of nerve number 7, facial nerve, which runs around the nerve number 6. So clearing it, so this is the nerve number 6, motor nucleus of axis of abducens. And you see that the fibers of the facial nerve form the loop. We call it internal genu of the facial nerve. And this internal genu is seen as the small elevation on the rhomboid fossa. Rhomboid fossa, again, is labeled by the thick solid line, the dark blue one. Then we can follow the nerve number 7, which leaves exactly here in this point. Yeah, this is nerve number 7, facial nerve. And then you see also the other structures, again repeating, this is superior cochlear nucleus and this is the inferior cochlear nucleus. As you could expect, we will speak about tract of hearing, because as we said in description of the rhomboid fossa, they are the superior inferior cochlear nuclei belonging to the tract, the hearing. And then we see also pontine nuclei, logically of nucleus number 5. This is also what we said. Then here is again the middle pedunculus, middle cerebral pedunculus, interconnecting the cerebellum with the pons, or better, pons and cerebellum. That's why it's the middle. And then we see also the vestibular nuclei. They are 4 together. We see only 2 on this section, and these vestibular nuclei belong to the tract of equilibrium, also provided by nerve number 8. And then we try to explain a little bit the bluish lines forming finally or running together with nerve number 8 with the vestibular cochlear. So these are the lines indicating the pathway of hearing. without any details, at the moment, we see that there is the interconnection between the inferior cochlear nucleus with a special enlarged nucleus, which is called trapezoid body or nucleus of trapezoid body. It passes to the opposite side, passing through the same trapezoid body, reaching the nucleus, the inferior cochlear nucleus on the opposite side. So there are two sides interconnected, but this is not all, because they are also the fibers that run up. They run to the superior cochlear nucleus. It goes to the opposite side and the contralateral side and ending at the superior cochlear nucleus of the contralateral side. So we will speak about the pathway of hearing in detail at the end, in the last chapter of the neuroanatomy. But this is just short introduction into the explanation how the system works. So it will be very important to know just the basic things. That means that where is the nucleus, where are the tracks, and know the basic information. If we say that this is the motor nucleus, correct, this must be in the red. If we say that this reticular formation will be connected with the vital functions, so we will explain it in the next lecture. When we speak about the medial lemniscus, we know from this moment this is the complex of the ascending tracts of general sensation, etc. When we will speak about the corticospinal tract, this will be the motor system, etc. So just this basic information. Then the last red line indicates explains the interconnection between the corticopontocerebellar. So the name is quite clear, corticopontocerebellar tracts. TRR means abbreviation for the tracts. We said that here we have the pontine nuclei, is a large number of pontine nuclei. They receive the information from the cortex, from the motor cortex. It descends on one side, crossing the median plane, passing up, and as a separate system, passes via the middle middle cerebellar peduncle as the corticopontocerebellar tract reaching cerebellum. So if we said at the beginning, the cerebellum is responsible for the coordination of the movements involved in the position of the body, keeping the position, upright position of the body, etc. So this whole system, the red one in our drawing called corticopontocerebellar, is the system which interconnects the cortex, the motor cortex, with the cerebellum. Details will be, of course, explained in the last chapter. Concerning the lemniscus, this is also one term, terminus technicus. We can look up. Yes, this will be sufficient. We are looking at the name lemniscus. Yes, we said that there are two lemnisci. We will see them. At the moment, we see just the medial lemniscus, but in the following section in the midbrain, we will see both, also the lateral. So when we look at the lemniscus is a loop. So lemniscus represents the ascending fibers. There is the majority or many many ascending fiber, general sensation fibers, and they reach the lemniscus, and via the lemniscus they go up to the thalamus and the cortex. This is the medial lemniscus, but the lateral lemniscus is specialized because it contains the only special sensory fibers, acoustic auditory tract. So lateral lemniscus connected with the acoustic system, acoustic tract, medial meniscus with the general sensation. And then we are approaching to the section number 4. We are looking at the mesencephalon. We could stay at this level. So mesencephalon could be explained in two sections. One, that drawing you remember from a very short introduction into the brainstem. We said that on the midbrain, we can identify simply the tectum, tegmentum and basis, or crura of cerebri. Tectum is here from the superior view. We see the four collicula, we call it corpora quadrigemina, which are situated below the pineal body. We will remember the pineal body is attached to the upper part. Of course, it's the different complex. We will explain it together with the diencephalon. So superior colliculi belonging to the pathway of vision, visual pathway. Inferior colliculi, the hearing. When we look at each part, tectum fully blue, tegmentum combined. So then we see the ascending tracts. These are what I put the dots. They are the lemnisci, both lemnisci, and also large nucleus, red nucleus, the motor tracts. Then on the left side, we see also the central canal. Then at the border between the tegmentum and basis lies the black substance, substantia nigra, this darker, not completely black, but it's more dark than the others. That's why the anatomists call it, or histologists call it substantia nigra, black substance, it's also motor. And finally, there is the basis crura, or crus cerebri, which is completely motor. We will see all the motor tracts found on the section. So now we are starting with the section number five. We are at the level of superior colliculi. We can draw both at the level of the superior colliculus or at the level of inferior colliculus, but in principle there is not big difference between these two, so that's why for simplification we are using just one, the section through the level of the superior colliculus. So again repeating, we are at the level of tectum, then tegmentum, and finally basis of crura. The level here is the central canal. We call it also Sylvian canal or mesencephalic aqueduct. You see so many synonyms are used. Around that is the gray matter, periaqual gray matter, putting set of dots indicating that this is the complex of neurons producing endorphins, also mentioned again. So starting with the first one, this is the nucleus of superior colliculus, more or less laminar, as you see the lines. And this colliculus is a part of the pathway of vision. Then follows the second, there is also small nucleus and the tract is, as you see, the tract, the tectospinal from tectum, one tract which goes, as we can follow the red line, is crossed here, is the tectospinal, sending the impulses from the tectum, from the, as we said, fully devoted to the corpora quadrigemina, hearing and vision, to the spinal cord. Then the second group of the bluish structures. First of all, that one is the mesencephalic nucleus of trigeminus, we mentioned. Then follows the reticular formation, is not bluish, but we have to mention it. Then follows the lateral lemniscus. Yes, we said the lateral lemniscus is the part of the pathway of hearing. And finally, the larger is the medial lemniscus for general sensation. So these are ascending tracts. One nucleus, big one, is the red nucleus, motor nucleus, and also we see one tract, rubro, because it's called also nucleus ruber, that's why we call it rubrospinal, also descending to the spinal cord. And then follows the black substance, motor system, and below the black substance lies the crus or the basis. Don't forget, please, also one, there is a different color, light green, Turkish green, which is called interpeduncular nucleus. We use as the first one, the name limbic system. There are two important systems in the whole complex of the activities of the brain. And first one will be reticular formation, a very important complex of the vital centers. We will speak about that. And also the second one is the limbic. Of course, I have to mention again that we will speak about limbic system later together with the telencephalon. Limbic system controls many activities of the body. And these two systems belong to the complicated ones extended in the different parts of the brain. So just to know from this moment that here this nucleus belongs to the limbic system. Good. And then look, now we are looking at the composition of this basis of Krura. Again, I know that this is difficult to fully understand how the systems work, but we have to distinguish between the things which are already explained and those which will be explained. First of all, we see two corticonuclear tracts, corticobulbar. What does it mean, this word? Corticonuclear means that they are tracts which run from the cortex and end at the level of motor nuclei of the cranial nerves. So this is easy to understand and imagine. What does it mean? This means that these two systems or complexes of the tracts are typical motor descending tracts, which descend from the cortex, from motor cortex of the telencephalon, and influence the activities of the cranial nerves, the motor ones. Then at the center, this whole block consists of the pyramidal tracts. So you see that at the center, they are the motor systems which run in well-defined courses. That means corticonuclear to the motor nuclei of the cranial nerves on both sides. And at the center lies the pyramidal system, pyramidal tracts. So I mean that up to here is everything clear. Then on both sides, laterally and medially, run the other tracts, which are called frontopontine and temporopontine, or they could be also the other names, like the using also occipital pontine, etc. But again, these names are relatively clear because they say that these tracts descend from the temporal areas of the cortex and pass into the pontine nuclei. You remember that we used in the previous section on the pons, we used the word pontine nuclei. So this, in general, corticopontine nuclei are these two tracts, or better, corticopontocerebellar. They descend in these areas from different parts of the cortex. But in principle, all these ones and these ones are called the corticopontine or corticopontocerebellar tracts. So this is the section of the midbrain at the level of the superior, or at least inferior colicus, but then the colicus will be inferior. So this is all to this. I'm sure that this is not so complicated. If you repeat it twice, three times, then everything will more clear. But we are adding one by one information to the other ones, so on the basement. So, and then we could, this is the last section, and we could say that the whole brainstem consists of many structures, consists of many important interconnections. They are nuclei, they are tracts, as here we see also tracts descending from the tectum. Many of them, the motor systems, must end at the level of the spinal cord. That's why we use the word tectospinal. Or rubrospinal also. So the names of the tracts are based on their origin insertion, many of them. Some of them not. A typical example is the pyramidal tract, because it originates from the pyramidal cells. The pyramidal cells are the triangular cells, as you see here, and they have many processes like that, and one long axon. So that's why we use the word pyramidal. But they form the pyramids finally. So also it could be derived from the name of the pyramid. So finalizing explanation, these sections are important for the studies, and we draw just only few at the level of the diencephalon, and then some section on the telencephalon. So this will not be so complicated to see the whole complex. There are not so many. Finalizing the explanation, thank you for your attention, and wishing you full success in the studies of this exciting topic, CNS. Thank you.